Your customers are craving a great-tasting, authentic pizza experience. That's why we offer Primo Molino Neapolitan-style flour, an affordable, high-performing flour that's a great alternative to imported Italian 00 flour. It's milled right here in North America, so you can always count on authentic crust texture and taste without the imported flour price. Using an imported flour today? Check out ardentmills.com to request a sample and try it for yourself.
Hi there, and welcome back to Checking In With. This is the show where Pizza Today, we check in with pizzeria operators around the country to see what's happening in the restaurant. Today, joining me is Josh Cowan, our creative director at Pizza Today. Hey, Josh.
Hello, hello.
Hello. And on the show with us today, we have Anthony Bergala from Romo's Pizza there in Glenmont, New York. Hey, how you doing, Anthony?
I'm doing good, guys. Thanks for having me today.
All right. Is weather Thanks crazy where you're at?
Well, and first off, happy National Pizza Day.
Yes. To you guys as well.
Yes, National Pizza Day. And actually, we're going to spin this out today because we want to talk National Pizza Day and you know, let the people listen to it. So what do you have planned today for National Pizza Day?
For National Pizza Day, well, actually, we're starting off donating 20 pizzas to our local mission group for the Slice Out Hunger event, Pizza Across America. So we're going to be doing that, sending that out around lunchtime. And then just kind of our normal, you know, everyday pizza specials. Tuesdays normally are our large cheese pizza special. We also do a chicken parm special for our dine-in side. But right now it's just strictly takeout. But that's a special that we always do that always brings in a big crowd for us.
Yeah. What type of day do you think you're planning for? Are you planning to overshoot last year's National Pizza Day, or are you going under it, or how are you planning for this day?
No, I think it's just going to be just as big, if not bigger. We do a lot of promotion through our Facebook and Instagram, and during the pandemic, our community has opened up many local pages to support, you know, not just, you know, a business in their town, but pretty much across our whole Albany County, which is pretty large. So, you know, restaurants go on there, they share their specials, customers or people who may have never heard of you before, they start coming. So it's been really good. We've been building up our base through things like that and through our just everyday Instagram and Facebook posts. And, you know, last year's National Pizza Day was pretty busy. So we're expecting the same this year.
Oh, that's cool.
And yeah, having a National Pizza Day back-to-back with Super Bowl, I mean, that's a 1-2 punch right there.
You're tired, right?
Yeah.
So what happened with your Super Bowl Sunday? I'm curious, because we've heard some pretty big numbers from folks.
Yeah, this year was probably one of the bigger ones that we've had. We tried a new system this year to make things run as smooth as possible, just as far as doing things in 15-minute increments as far as how many pizzas we can handle, you know, during that 15 minutes. We tried to make things, you know, come out as smooth as possible. It got pretty crazy, you know, probably about an hour before game time was when we got hit the hardest. But I thought, you know, our crew handled it pretty well. You know, for the amount of orders that you take in during that 2-hour stretch, you know, I thought it went really well.
Yeah. Now, did you, you know, with such an influx of orders and especially to-go orders, did you change up your line or how you process things for such a big day? I know big days, you kind of have to rethink your game plan a little.
Yeah. So normally what we did in the past on Super Bowls, we always treated it kind of like a Friday night, where on our line, we have two people running the ovens, two people making pizzas, and then we have one person specifically just like stretching out doughs for us so we could kind of stay ahead of the game. We've done pretty much done that every year. And, you know, for the past few years, we kind of fell into like an issue where, you know, we were trying to get things out about 10, 15 minutes early so we can make sure that the orders coming in after were always going to be on time. And we saw that starting to slip a little bit. So this year, we added another person to that line where we had one person stretching the doughs. I was saucing and cheesing everything, and then I just passed those pizzas on to the two other guys, and they just put the toppings on and then gave them to the oven guys. So that actually worked out really well for us. We had no issues this year with that, so we were pretty happy and with the change. So it might be something that we have to look into on Friday nights as well.
Yeah. Now, is it just Friday nights as far as your big nights, or are you seeing big Friday nights on Saturday and Thursday as well, or is it kind of a mix?
Yeah, so, I mean, right now, the things change a little bit with the times as far as, you know, the winter. So for us, normally early in the week, it's pretty quiet. Tuesday, Wednesday is pretty quiet. Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and even Sundays are busier than normal. And then where, you know, in the summer times, it's for some reason, it's like earlier in the week, we're busy. And then the weekends, people are out doing things. So it's a little bit slower. It changes with the seasons, but, you know, it stays overall, the numbers stay pretty consistent. It just changes how it comes in.
So where are you guys at currently with the, you know, of course, with the COVID situation? Are you 25% capacity or how's that going right now?
Yeah, so right now our indoor is allowed 50% capacity. My dining room was a little bit smaller to begin with. It was kind of like that old school feel where the tables were close to each other. You know, there wasn't a lot of space. So when they reopened at 50%, we moved things around multiple ways to try to maximize as many tables as we could have. And it just was kind of, you know, 7, maybe 8 tables. We would have to eliminate our bar seats because they were too close. So we just kind of made the determination that, you know, we're better off just staying as is. And when things open up a little bit more to where, you know, it made it worth bringing back all those extra employees that, you know, we would reopen. So right now we're still strictly takeout.
Yeah, we do hear that a lot. You know, when you crunch the numbers and you do the financial analysis of can you do it with 25 or 50% financially, does it make sense? I think that, you know, making a wise decision if you have a small spot. Now, you have actually moved several times. You've moved a couple of different times since opening in 2009. Kind of what's caused those moves and how were you able to, you know, keep your customers in a flow and keep everything moving forward?
Yeah, so when we opened back in 2009, I bought an existing pizzeria that was pretty much on its way out. An older gentleman was running it, and he kind of just – he had his time and he didn't really want to do it anymore. So I took it over. I took it over with zero experience. I had never been in the pizza business, any restaurant business at all. My uncles were in it when I was younger. And I remember going there and saying, oh, this is cool. You know, I'm going to open a pizza shop. And I was lucky because the gentleman that I bought it from, his business wasn't very busy. So it gave me time to learn and to grow to where if I was thrown into something that was already busy, I probably would not be here talking to you today. Yeah, so we started off in a small spot. It was 600 square feet. It was pretty much just a small kitchen with a open the door, little takeout area to pick your food up and go. We did that for about 3 years, and I outgrew that spot. You know, word, you know, the new pizzeria in town and things like that, getting myself into the sports teams and, you know, getting people talking, we outgrew it. You know, we needed bigger ovens. We needed more space, cooler space, and we wanted people to be able to come in and sit down. So there was a spot that was available up front in the plaza that we had been renting in, and it wasn't much bigger than what we had, but we were now going to be exposed because the spot that I was in before was literally on the back corner. So you could drive by there every day and not know me, like not know I was there unless, you know, you were a customer and you knew I was there. So we did that more or less for the exposure. We added a few more seats to it. But it wasn't really dining. It was more, you know, have your slices, come in for, you know, a quick bite type of thing. We did that for 3 years, ran into the same issue. We outgrew it. We needed more ovens. We needed, you know, bigger walk-ins, things like that. The only spot that was available was a former beverage center in my plaza. So that was a little over 4,000 square feet. So I'm at about 1,000 square feet at the time going to 4,000. I was like, well, we can't really do a 4,000 square foot takeout spot. So what can we do? So we decided to go bigger, do dine-in, bring different items to, you know, to our menu, different styles of pizza. And at that point, when we were in that process, I hooked up with Tony and Laura, went out to California, did the international pizza school with them, learned the different styles of pizza, just learned a lot more than just pizza from them. And I brought that back here, and, you know, that has taken off. And, you know, we've been doing this now in the restaurant for 5 years with our take-in or our dine-in. And, you know, it's been going great. And prior to the pandemic, we were actually going to be moving again into a larger spot, much larger spot that was going to offer us more dining space, a larger bar, a huge party room to do events and things like that, which our town is lacking. So, you know, we were really looking forward to that. And literally, I would say, 2 weeks before the pandemic hit, we were getting ready to sign the contract, and my lawyer was like, put a halt to that, okay?
So. Yeah, was that something you're looking forward to maybe next year, or are you still planning on doing?
Yeah, so the plan right now, the plan, we've been talking to them again, and the plan right now is to maybe within the next month or two to go ahead and move forward with that, and we're hoping that probably early fall, hopefully like right around when football kicks back off, we'll be over in that new spot, and that'll push us through like the nice holiday season, and then you know, get the name out even more, and you know, carry us through these, you know, the early winter months.
Yeah. That'd be about the perfect timing. Hopefully dining will be full up by then, so
And you know, I have a feeling that, you know, after this pandemic subsides and we're all able to get out, it's gonna be big. Like, everyone's gonna be just wanting that social interaction and wanting to be around other people and wanting to be in their communities. So I think it's gonna explode.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, we're getting those requests now. I mean, we have customers that come in, you know, every time they pick up, they're like, are you opening up, when are you opening up, and we're just like, soon, you know. So we're kind of waiting, you know. It might get to the point to where, you know, if we do move ahead with this move, that we'll just wait until we can open that up, depending on, you know, on what changes with our capacity and stuff like that, you know, until then. But you know, people are definitely, you know, itching to get back in.
Now, so is that new spot in the still in the same complex?
No, it's literally across the street.
Okay. Oh, okay. So you stay in the same area.
Yeah, literally across the street. The big thing, obviously, you know, it's a bigger place, but the parking is, you know, 10 times larger than what I have now. That's actually probably one of the main reasons why we were looking to move from this spot, was because our parking became such an issue. Our dining room opens at 4 o'clock. So I would say Tuesday through Saturday between 5 and 9 o'clock, it's almost impossible to find a spot inside of the plaza. You know, you have people that would come in to pick up and they're like, I can't park anywhere, I'm double parked out front, you know. And, you know, we had people say, you know, we drove by, we saw we weren't going to get in, we went somewhere else. So we were just like, you know what, this is just going to get worse as, you know, time goes. So let's try to figure something out now.
So how many styles of pizza are you currently have on your menu right now?
Yeah. So currently on our menu, on our dine-in menu, we have Chicago deep dish. We do an artisan style pizza. We do our normal everyday style. And then during the week, we run different specials. We'll do a Chicago cracker thin. We'll do grandma. We'll do Detroit style. We'll do different Sicilian style pizzas. So we're trying to change it up. Normally what we do is, once a week or maybe twice a week, we showcase a specific pizza and we say, this week's specialty pizzas are Detroit style pizza. And normally we run out every week. I'll make 40 or 50 of them. And, you know, once they're gone, they're gone. And phones open at 10, normally by 12, they're sold out for the night. So it's people really like them.
Yeah. Now you personally, it's National Pizza Day. I got to know, what is your favorite style? Do you have one, and why do you love it?
I do have, I have a few actually. That's why I do. No,
I'm the same way. They waver. They waver. It depends on what kind of mood I'm in.
Yeah. So like right now I'm really enjoying the Chicago cracker thin. It's funny. When I went out to California and worked with Tony and Laura, I had no interest at all in Chicago. I was like, nobody's going to like it out here. I'm not even bothering with it. So I didn't pay attention to any of that stuff. I never went to Capo's and trained. So and then when I came back, I was like, well, maybe people will like it because they can't get it here. Yeah. So I started off with the Chicago deep dish and people love that. And then I remember trying the cracker thin for the first time and I was just like, it's okay. And then I had it in Vegas during Tony's pre-party. I'm like, wow, this is a lot better than I thought. Mm-hmm. So I started, you know, working on that and I put it out, and that's another one of the pizzas that, you know, gets a lot of requests. We get Facebook messages every week. Are you doing the cracker thin? When are you doing it next? Yeah. And things like that. So that one I love. I really like the Detroit style, but, you know, your typical, you know, thin crust New York styles, you know, one of my favorites as well. Yeah.
Agreed. I know. I grew up on Chicago thin, so Chicago thin is just that's my jam. So, but I love them all.
Yeah.
So, and real quickly, just we'll end it on one last question around National Pizza Day. What has been your favorite specialty pizza that you've created that just went gangbusters and you just loved that special?
So a specific pizza, I did it actually in Vegas a few years ago competing. I did a grandma style pizza. I made a little bit of a spicier tomato sauce, and I used the sliced hot calabrese salami, and I finished that with, I also put a natural casing pepperoni on that as well, and then I finished that with a little bit of arugula, a little bit of fior di latte mozzarella, and I drizzled that with a little bit of Mike's Hot Honey as well. Man, so it was kind of like a spicy and sweet pizza, and we have that on our menu, and people love it. That's definitely one of the more favorite ones that I've created on my own. Another one that we've been doing as a special lately, I call it the spicy clam, and it's a red sauce pizza with fresh clams on it. And there's a local product that we use. It's called Hot Crispy Oil, and it's like fried shallots, fried onions, and you just drizzle it on the pizza, and it's phenomenal. It's phenomenal. So, you know, I have a lot of things that like I work on that I like keep behind doors because I'm like, you know what, I'm going to do this at the next competition or something like that. So yeah. I don't want to get it out there too much, but you know, those two pizzas are probably two of my more favorite ones that I've made lately.
Good deal. Are you competing in Vegas this year?
Yeah, I'm signed up this year. I am doing traditional, first time doing traditional. Ah. The last couple of times I've did it, I've done pan. So I wanted to change it up a little bit this year.
I love going and sampling the traditional pizza. I mean, that's just kind of my jam right there. I'm a traditional as far as when it comes to pizza. So it's like you really find out the really good pizzas when you're in the traditional style.
Yep.
Absolutely. So how long have you been perfecting this pizza that you're going to compete with in June? Have you started the process, or is it one that you just always had and you just are ready to put it out there?
So the one that I will be doing this year at the expo in June, I've actually been working on it a little bit lately. I've actually been working with some of my pizza teammates, Derek Sanchez, and talking a little bit with Joe Carlucci as well, just, you know, creating this dough, perfecting it. It wasn't much different than what I was doing before as far as the ingredients that are involved, but it was the process. It was different as far as how I handled it. And it's made a huge difference. And just trying to come up with, you know, that traditional, you know, tomato sauce that, you know, just really, you know, gives it a good bite. And obviously using good quality, you know, cheese and other ingredients that I'm going to go with. But the dough was the main thing that I've been trying to work on right now and perfect that. And then everything else, I think, you know, will fall in line with what I'm already doing.
Yeah. How much do you have to adapt your dough for the Vegas desert kind of environment? Do you have to adapt it for the competition pretty much?
So the last couple of times I've been lucky enough to go to either Metro or Pizza Rock and make my dough. So I've been lucky to do that. Some of the other competitions, like in AC, where I'm only a few hours away, I make it here and just drive it down there.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I may do that this year, you know, try to fly it over with me. I've never done it, so maybe I'll do it and see how it ends up when I get off. And then if it doesn't, I just go make it again somewhere else.
Yeah.
But it's definitely different. I mean, being in the convention center, I've always noticed that I need to take my dough out to ferment earlier than I normally would back at home, you know, maybe do an overnight, something like that. But, you know, it definitely changes how you do things because the climate's different and you know, being inside, the weather's different.
We're going to have that summer element this year. It's going to be June. It's going to be 1,000 degrees. But
it's dry heat, Josh. It's dry.
It's dry. I'll take dry heat any day over this humidity. So, but Anthony, we'll let you get going on your National Pizza Day. So good luck to you and your staff today.
All right. Thanks, guys. I appreciate you having me.
Great talking to you.
Thanks, guys.
Bye-bye.